Yeah. Good noon, honorable vice chancellors, and welcome to this technical session. After having the interactive sessions and sessions with apex body, this is a variation, and we'll start with the technical aspect now. This session is on disruptive technology in higher education, opportunities and challenges. When we have chosen this topic, I had the opportunity to read about disruptive technologies, and I felt that the term disruptive technologies itself is a mysterious term, and the layman understands it as a negative connotation, whereas the scientists say that it is inevitable and it leads to progress, and we really have to understand what it is and discuss about this and give resolutions which can improve our higher education system. The honorable chairperson of this session is none other than Professor Sancheti, who is an expert of the field. Sir, I request you to come on the dais. We have as a speakers for this session Dr. Rajiv Sangal, Vice Chancellor, IIT BHU. So may I request you to come on the dais? We have Professor Anoop Swaroop, Vice Chancellor, Jagran Lake City University, Bhopal. We have Professor Manik Rao Salunke, Vice Chancellor, Bharati Vidyapeet, Pune. Sir, I request you to take your chair on the dais. And we couldn't have Dr. Rajiv Yerwadekar and Vidya Yerwadekar. Instead, we have Dr. Anita Patankar. Madam, I request you to come on the dais. Sir, Chairman, sir, I request you to take the floor.
Good afternoon, friends. Just a minute back, we have landed into this zone. It's not anymore good morning. We are late already for starting this session by almost an hour because it was scheduled at, if I am right, at 11 a.m. itself. Anyway, we have a distinguished panel of experts who are going to deliberate on the subject of disruptive technologies in higher education, opportunities and challenges. As you know that the disruption is an integral part of our life. It sometimes happens because of desire, sometimes it happens because of the technology, it sometimes also happens accidentally. And it's not an accident, but that we have the disruption word mentioned twice in the second line of the title of this particular event. If you can see, it starts with the disruptive technology and probably ends with the age of disruption. And therefore, we ought to discuss a little bit more on disruption. Yesterday also, we had some opportunity to discuss about disruption. So, The session itself is also disrupted, at least in terms of time, and now it's going to be in terms of sequence also. Reason for that is that we have two experts who are hard-pressed for their time, and that is Professor Anoop Swaroop, Vice Chancellor, Jagran Lake University, Bhopal, who has to leave and catch his flight, and so is the Professor Manik Rao Salunke, Vice Chancellor, Bharati Vidyapeet, Pune, who is also the vice president designate for the AIU. Both of them have to leave, and therefore, I will give them precedence over anyone else in terms of sharing their thoughts so that they can be a little more comfortable when they talk to us, and also they can leave this place by 12:30. I have lots of ideas and views on the subject of disruption, but I'll probably reserve it for a later time once the two experts have finished their talks, or maybe I'll probably try to share those only in the end. So with this small background and a small change in the one of the speakers, that we don't have Dr. Rajiv Yerwadekar and Dr. Vidya Yerwadekar available to us, and instead Madam Anita Patankar, is that right, Madam? Patankar is available from the Symbiosis International University, Pune. So with this small change in this announcement, I'd first like to welcome Professor Anoop Swaroop, the Vice Chancellor from Jagran Lake City University, for his address. And Once again, with a request to all the speakers that they'll kindly maintain their time of something like 10 minutes on the subject. Thank you.
So, a very good afternoon. Thanks, Professor Sancheti. To initiate, let me say, Nahi Gyanen Sadrashi Pavitramehi Vidyate. These are the words from Bhagavad Gita. And while I was sitting along with all of you, all the very distinguished vice chancellors, I was just thinking of the connect between disruption and spiritualism. And what struck me most, and in fact, I should confess, I should tell you, I wear another shoe, and that is an important, more important issue than being a vice chancellor. I am also the chairman of Center for Global Non-Killing, based at Hawaii. So non-killing is an opportunity which goes beyond non-violence.
Which one?
Thank you. So as knowledge, okay, thank you. So I won't take much time. As Professor Sancheti just mentioned, we have got a flight to catch, and all that time we were perturbed about that part. But I'll come straight to the slides, and like I was mentioning, can I have the slideshow, please, on this? Okay, it's a slideshow, then it's fine. So let me tell you, when I was mentioning it to you about knowledge, knowledge is all about disruption. And knowledge coupled with creativity and innovation, it can provide a solution to that disruption. So while in the governing body of AIU, we had the opportunity, and partly I am also a culprit in this title. So I should tell you, it became too long. But at the bottom of it all is human values. Let me come straight to the point. And in my capacity as the chairman of Center for Global Non-Killing, I was in Tokyo, in Japan, a couple of months back. And there was this particular painting, which I would, which would be on your screen. I was very much struck by this. This is a painting by Hukawi, and the image is of Mount Fuji, which is just on the side. On the back side is a big wave, a tsunami of sorts. You know the tsunami which struck Japan? He was influenced by that. So this tsunami is going to overtake, and there is a boat with people. So I was thinking that these people are nobody else, but our industry is at large, and we are facing a disruptive change. And we are unaware of a wave which is going to swallow all of us. And while I'm talking about this, I should mention that I'm also a member of the World Future Society, futurism, as we know. It is predicted that in next 10 years, almost half of the industries will vanish because there is a tsunami. You know the tsunami of MOOCs, massive open online courses. But there is a massive tsunami of skill-based education, which you know. And that skill-based education is going to overtake degrees. And these degrees will no more be important enough because they are not required by the industry. So let me come straight to the point. And that is, now looking at our past, change has always happened. And the future is very disruptive, as we know it has always been. Now the question is, what is happening in this world? The world is going to change in enormous ways. And one of the changes is that almost 5 million students from across the globe, they have been going internationally to get higher education. This figure is going to double by 2020. And then every 3 years it's going to double. Now you can imagine that there is a mass of people who are going to drive the globalization internationally, or you can call it as internationalization of higher education. It's happening here and now. So these are the things which are outstanding. Now let me bring you back to the Universal Declaration on Higher Education. This is, as you would see, I'll just quickly, just for the sake of brevity, I will come to 9, and which keeps about, Article 9 talks about innovation. And then I will come straight to Article 17, and also Article 16. Now you'll see it is all about networking, about partnerships. And if it is partnerships and networking, then internationally, as it is in India, industries are in the same boat. We are going to face an enormous challenge before us. Now, innovation and skilling, these are the two things which are going to drive the whole bastion of industry education. Let me tell you, my friend Thomas Friedman, he has written a couple of books. One of them was Hot, Flat and Crowded. Second was The World is Flat. And the third book which he came up with, that was us, that is about America as you know it. He was talking about three C's. The three C's are character, cooperation and creativity. Now, I was thinking what he mentioned in the Western world equally applies to the Eastern world, to us in India. What we need is character, and good character can come from good schooling, not from the universities. In universities, we have been talking about value-based education. But don't you all agree that the crop of students who are getting, they are already having the values which they were already instilled in their schooling or in their upbringing. It's too late for us to, you know, instill anything different. Professor Srivastava, you made a very good point today when you were talking about Buddham Sharanam Gacchami. But I was just wondering, where do we begin? It has to be from the primary education, not from the university education. And that is where we as a country are lagging or perhaps failing. Now the question is, where do we get creativity? It comes from investment in higher education, from innovation. And that means 6% of your GDP should actually go to education as such. In India, we are spending how much on higher education? He said, you said it, 1%. About a couple of decimals here or there. So. It is such an unfortunate state of affairs, years after years, and I have had the misfortune, I would say, you may call it a fortune, I was in the government, and I was a joint secretary of the commissioner in the Ministry of Finance, and I was also privy to the budget exercise. And this time also when the budget came, I was hoping something for education, nothing was there, as you all know it. So, now I am on the other side, in the private sector, and I can see the bleak future which we are going to be challenging right now before us. Let me go to the next few. I'll just quickly tell you about the few trends which are going to drive international education. Can I have the better view of this? Okay. So it's like, okay. So then, okay. So let me tell you, it is innovation, creativity, which is going to be the buzzword in the time to come. And when it is innovation and creativity, what the industries are supposed to do. So I'm just coming straight to the trends which are going to drive the industries of tomorrow. I'm mindful that my friend is also looking at his watch, so we have to catch our flight. But what is going to happen is that the industries, as we know, the traditional education, as we know, is going to disappear, is going to dissipate. Now, we are going to have a skill-based education which will be online, which will be virtual. And the technology which we are going to face is BYOD. Have you heard about the BYOD? That is the bring your own device. As a professor at Monash, almost now 10 years back, I could see that BYOD was the mantra there, because all the students had their own devices. So we were not thinking in terms of a PowerPoint also, as you see it now. They were having their own laptops. So everything was there. So they were running their own thing and we had to keep pace. So it was an enormous challenge for the teachers to keep pace with the students. Then there is a virtual world. There is a semantic web. And I'm sure that many of you would already be aware, so I'm not going into those details. The virtual world, the semantic web, the extended virtual reality. You must be knowing about the Internet of Things, IoT. You already, some of you must be having, must have tried the Samsung ocular set, and you could have seen the 3D world, how it happens. We have already been approached, and I think many of the industries must already be having German companies approaching us for a virtual processing line, where the student, mechanical engineering student, can actually work on a Mercedes plant. So these things are happening quite fast. Apart from the Internet of Things, there is another revolution which is happening, and that is about the artificial intelligence and the blockchain technology. Artificial intelligence is going to drive our future in many ways. While I was sitting here, I got a WhatsApp message, and I got the message that an unknown billionaire has put $10 billion on getting his own brain mapped. Now, when you can get your brain mapped, the world would be different, I'm very sure. And so is with the Internet of Things. You can have virtual reality happening here and now. So I'm not going to go into all those details. I only wish I had more time to be with you all. But we have to be prepared for a future which is different, which is very disruptive, but at the core of it all is the human value. And human values, we were talking in the morning session, I'm glad that we are devoting more time to human values, spiritualism. Of course, that is the heart of everything. And on another occasion, if I get an opportunity, I would be more than happy in talking to you about the Center for Global Non-Killing, which I had as its chairman. We have done enormous work, and I'm sure that in the time to come, we'll be doing great work with everybody's support. I'm also on the governing board of the Association of Universities of Asia Pacific. So I'm going to talk about the disruption which has happened here. I've given them the topic, and in the next 2 months, they're also having a, and the topic is virtually the same. So the whole world is on the same platform when we talk about disruption, about the technology, about the change which is going to sweep all of us. But as somebody said, and I quote, that we should keep our windows open, but we should not be swept off our feet as we go. So with these words, thank you all. Thank you so much, my very distinguished Vice Chancellors. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Sarup. Would like to have one or two questions from the audience for you, because you'll be leaving. You won't be available to us later. Yes, sir, please. Yeah, can someone take a microphone there? Or you can come closer and speak a little louder, sir. Okay. To begin with, yeah.
So this is very coincidental that I am a keynote speaker there also, and the topic is same. Fortunately, there I am supposed to speak for 20 minutes, so I'll have more time to. Yes, sir, please.
Let me speak loudly.
Sir. Wonderful, sir. Actually, this was, in fact, I rushed through the last few slides, you must have seen. I was talking about a process-based business plan. Every university is supposed to have a business plan. We have prepared at our university a business plan for year 2020 and year 2030. The whole idea is that unless we foresee, we make a SWOT analysis, the strength, the weaknesses, the opportunities, and the threats, we are not in a position to really face the future which is there before us. And I'm sure many of our very distinguished vice chancellors must be from a science background and from an engineering background. Unless you do a proper SWOT analysis and a proper business plan, you are not going to make any headway. I can say that it is said that man, and take it as women, is the crowning achievement of the evolutionary history of humankind. We have reached this level that we are talking and discussing, otherwise, as it is said, yaar hume fakr hai ki hamare pardade langur the, is it not? So we are talking about this only because we do a logical, scientific analysis of things. And as you rightly mentioned, it need not be goal-based. It has to be process-based, whatever we do. Good, sir. Thank you. Okay. Sir.
One more, please. Anyone of you.
Sir, the question which you have just raised is, I think, it's so interesting and so important because at Jizyan, almost 7 months back I was there, and the same issue was being raised, not by one, but at least by a dozen vice-chancellors there. And they were saying, what will happen to the traditional or conventional education which is face-to-face? Many of the very esteemed, distinguished vice-chancellors felt that face-to-face education will always stay. But then somebody said, in a virtual world, you don't need face-to-face. And that also hikes the cost of studentship or learning. So, as you said, the new education is going to change, and that is why I said in the beginning, futurism have made a study that half the universities will be disappearing in the next 10 years. So we have to be prepared and we have to adapt. And to be adaptive, we have to be innovative and we have to be creative. Now there is a new word which is taken over from creative and innovative, and that is critical thinking. That is analytical thinking, and partly it answers your question because analysis, or as we know it, now business analytics has taken over as a big subject in most industries, including ours. So analytical or critical thinking is going to show the way forward. And as you said, we'll have to think, devise new ways how to be face to face with the students, maybe in a virtual reality world.
Thank you, sir. This will be the last question, because otherwise Professor Salunkar will be late. Yes, sir.
Writer during the MOOCs conference, he told in Hindi, I will repeat, he was addressing a professor who was telling about MOOCs. He told in Hindi, jo baat tujhme hoti hai tere tasveer mein nahi hoti.
Arre wah, I think we should all give him a big clap.
Yeah,
because you misunderstood. I never said that MOOC is like a tsunami which is going to overtake us.
Yeah.
I said that the whole lot of technological change is going to be like a tsunami.
Yes.
And that is what the artist had conceived.
It's okay, sir.
Yeah.
Let us also know the other way.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jo baat tujhme hoti hai, wo tere tasveer mein nahi hoti. That is one thing. Secondly, this disruptive technology, maybe words are new, but concept is not new. Famous Marxist philosophy says, in order to learn, you have to unlearn.
Absolutely.
It's a disruptive philosophy.
Very true.
From feudalism, then to the capitalism, capitalism to the socialism, the societies were disrupted. Means of production was disrupted. And societies evolved. And we need not take it as negative philosophy.
Sir, as you have said,
secondly, please let me finish.
Sir.
Then, you know, with the help of, I have Android mobile, so all of us. With the Android mobile, laptops disappeared.
Absolutely.
When laptops came, the computers we keep on the tables disappeared. When computers came, landlines disappeared. You can trace this as disruptive.
Sir, as you have said,
it is only the evolution of the technology which brings more comfort, and the technology which is not answering to the needs of the people will vanish.
Sir, I am not controverting you. I am just saying, and this is a case which I made at Zian also. I said many tsunamis have come, including MOOCs, but we cannot be complacent. We have to be very receptive, and we have to be adaptive to change. So this is it. So thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Sir, just I don't
can
want
I
to
disrupt
answer.
This particular just, question, sir?
I
because Professor Salunkar will
no,
get
no
late.
Question,
request
sir,
you to kindly
so,
take it.
No question, sir. Just I wanted to pose this to you. Do you think yourself, sir? Not, don't answer.
Okay.
The thing is that, sir, is technology is value neutral? Is technology is class neutral?
Fine, sir. It's a food for thought.
So
we'll all ponder
thought.
Over this and discuss
so,
it.
But we have placed that sir, value, human value
Swaroop,
is at the center.
Professor
so
Swaroop,
let's think.
Now you'll be encroaching on his time, because let's respect Professor Salunkar also. Please thank Professor Swaroop for his very valuable inputs and address. I request Professor Salunke to now kindly talk to us.
Very good afternoon to you all, dignitaries on dais, dignitaries of the dais, friends. At the outset, I would like to thank the host institute for kind hospitality and for AIU for this particular opportunity. I have to rush, I have a flight. So just what I thought, in my lecture, I thought I will take a practical approach. New philosophy of NAC. What has been implemented, I think it is a disruptive technology in higher education. What was the previous method? Just I would like to, and we know, since yesterday we are discussing about this disruptive technology. Just now we have a really good discussion. It is an innovation that makes a complemented and expensive product simpler, cheaper, and thereby attract a new set of customers. So in NAC also, I think NAC is not in position. In 23 years, they have assessed only 10,000 colleges, and we have 40,000 colleges. Even as far as the universities, they are close to 300. They have to assess 800 universities, and so many universities will be there. So I will not go into what is this technology, MOOCs, so much discussion, so I will remove everything from my presentation. What was the NAC's old view? And yesterday, that World Bank person has mentioned about three issues. One of the issues is assessment and accreditation. He has clearly mentioned that particular issue. Previously, we used to assess the colleges and the universities with qualitative peer team. The peer team feels B grade, the B grade was awarded. When the peer team feels A, that was the thing. But new methodology, it will be quantitative. 70% online assessment they are going to do, and only 30% 2 days visit, there will be the peer team will go and assess. So this will be entire, there is a change. It is, will be a technological change, and old view, it was a qualitative peer judgment, and now it will be more quantitative indicator evaluation. So we feel the method will be, this new paradigm shift, this will be more effective. And I don't know, it's very difficult to change from one method to another method. There are several issues, and now few things are very simple. Previously we used to apply, we used to have letter of intent. Now both the things, in one go, it will be possible to know whether you are eligible for assessment and accreditation. This is very simple. But review process, I would like to tell the criteria. I will not go into the silent features of the what new NAC framework is. But what is the real change? The previously, the method was on input-based. Means they asked students, curricula, faculty, non-teaching staff, facilities, and infrastructure. In new methodology, they are taking into account outputs, the skilled of the employable graduates, research publications outputs, contributions to the community. And another thing I would like to mention is the process has become more important. Processes is teaching learning, staff development, student support, evaluation, research, administration. Now, as far as the quality framework is concerned, it is the same. Previously, we used to have 7 criteria. Again, there will be the 7 criteria. Only the criteria third has been changed. The research consultancy and extension, the research extension and innovation, this criteria has been incorporated. And there is a change in the last criteria. Previously, it was innovation and best practices, and I'm very happy in this particular case, we are talking about human values. And that particular part has been incorporated, institutional values and best practices. This is one of the things. Now, as far as the framework is concerned, it is almost same. Only already I have mentioned for colleges. They are not involved in curriculum development because university and we used to give the marks. So in new framework, affiliated colleges, this they will not ask about the curriculum development question. Only for autonomous colleges and university, this particular thing is there. And the consultancy, there is no consultancy almost at colleges. That particular part has been removed, there is a change. And even in this alumni engagement, there are some changes. Otherwise, both the things are same. Now, in this particular framework, this is a total framework, how the indicators, but the number of questions, they have been reduced. Relevance to local, regional, and national and global, this new design in curriculum, this is more output-based. Already I have mentioned feedback collection, analysis, action taken, and posting on website. Everything should be on the website. They have third-party assessment. Third-party assessment, they have appointed one agency. That agency will be always monitor your website, and whether you are trying to make some anything which is not done by you and you are claiming, that thing they will try to point out, and that is the new thing they would like to have. Now, in this case, less than, now there is another one more thing, it is recently happened, you will not see on the, even on the website. Last week they have decided they will give 5% for weightage for matrix where you can opt that I don't want this particular matrix is, I should not answer. Because some universities, there is so much diversity in the university, all the questions, some universities are women university. And it's not possible. Yeah. To answer some of the questions. So what has been done? In this case, you can opt 5%, you will say these questions are not applicable to us. Matrix maximum of weightage of 20 per criteria can be opted out. And criteria 7, that is a human values, or this particular is essential, no matrix can be opted out in this case. And essential matrix cannot be out. There are some issues. Student teacher ratio is an essential matrix. So you can't opt out this matrix. Qualitative matrix cannot be opted out. The distribution of the weightage, already I have mentioned, the 7.1 institutional values and social responsibilities. And particularly, they are more interested in environmental consciousness than innovations, and there is one more concept they have added, is institutional distinctiveness. If you are tribal university, some weightage you can get. If you are a woman university, or anything specific, you can give in institutional distinctiveness. There are gender equity questions. We discussed a lot about this particular thing. A lot of weightage has been given, whether it has been incorporated in your curriculum. Women appointments, women appointed in non-teaching staff, several gender issues, social security, counseling, common room, all these things they have taken into account. Then in another thing, alternate energy initiatives, replacement of the existing, all these bulbs and all these things, energy audit, wastewater management, rainwater harvesting, everything they have taken, and green practices including bicycle, public transport, plastic free campus, green landscaping, budget for, this is a, nobody is having the separate budget. Now they are looking for a budget and there is a marks are given, budget for green initiatives, differently abled, the Divyang friendliness, resource available in the institution, physical facilities, provision of lift, ramps, and all these things, scribes, examination, etc. Distinctiveness, they are asking one of the best practice, exemplary performance area aligned to the institute's vision, priority, thrust, area of uniqueness, rural development, tribal upliftment, women empowerment, minority empowerment, skill development, and vocational education. Human values and professional ethics, code of conduct, handbook for the student, teacher, support staff, display the core values in institution and websites, number of activities conducted for promotion of national integration and communal harmony, and institution makes conscious efforts to promote value professional ethics for academic integrity, transparency in transaction. There are 30% weightage.
Sir.
Yeah.
A minute or two.
Yeah. Maybe. Last minute. Yeah. Inputs from the student. This will be done. Previously, they used to have direct interaction with the students. But it will be now, it will be online. This is a student, and the weightage is almost 3 to 5%. Then inputs, qualitative metrics, already I have mentioned. And inputs from qualitative metrics, it is almost 70%, and 30%, already I have mentioned. Student satisfaction survey, already I have mentioned, so I will not go into the details. See, one thing I would like to, in Vice Chancellor Forum, actually I thought I will discuss this issue, whether, what kind of technology we would like to have, where we should be personalized and where the things should be standardized. This is such type of, suppose mobile is having this pad, then it's very difficult because new method is used. What is wrong with this dial pad? Immediately you can say it is not in the regular format. But if you go to a pad, this is a regular standard dial pad and we can use it. Like this thing, we should know what should be standardized. So dial pad must be standardized. So in technology, we should know what should be standardized and what should be the personalized. And in forum, this particular forum, I will be happy if you could discuss this particular issue, what things in technology should be standardized and what things should be personalized. I have detailed presentation on this, what things should be done, standardized and personalized, but I don't have the time, so I will not discuss all these issues, but at this particular forum, I will be happy if you could discuss these particular issues, which things should be standardized, which things should be personalized or institution specific. We get every day one letter from the UGC, AIU, provide the data, and we are not in position. Because the reason you know, because every time the format is different. Thank you all.
Thank you, Professor Salunke. Kindly take your seat here. We'll have one or two questions for Professor Salunke. He obviously talked about the changes which are brought in the new NAC system, which we are all going to face. So if you have any questions about that or anything which he's talked about, standardization and personalization, a quick one. Okay, over there, please.
Already I have made it very clear in my first slide itself. Humne aapko bata diya tha ki this method will be very simple. It's not possible for them to have assessment and accreditation of so many institutes in the time. Are ye disruptive technology hai? That is the one thing I would like to mention. This is a new technology.
Yeah.
Okay. No, that's what I'm saying.
Fine, sir. Thank you for your response. I think changes of greater extent, lesser extent, in our own perception, we take it disruption or not disruption. Yeah. Certainly in NAC with 70% going quantitative, there is a big change. So Professor Salunke in his wisdom tried to enlighten us with that. Let's appreciate that. Let's thank Professor Salunke and Professor Swaroop, both of them, for their thoughts on this important topic. They both would be leaving us immediately because they have flight to catch. Thank you, sir. Thanks from the side of AIU also for joining us here. we will continue our journey and save time, because time is an important value and we don't want to have disruption as far as our lunch and other programs are concerned. So the next speaker is very distinguished, Professor Rajiv Sangal, a person from Banaras itself, who started his journey in Kanpur, IIT Kanpur, later became the founder director of IIIT Hyderabad, very well known. Currently, he's heading the BHUIT here in Banaras, and he has also had distinction of leading the Banaras Hindu University for some time. I welcome Professor Sangal. He's going to talk to us about the values, which are also embedded in our topic here, that how values and the disruptions are connected. We welcome Professor Sangal for his address. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sancheti. My talk is on incorporating human value course in higher education. Somehow it has been put in this session. So I just accept it and then go ahead. We have been talking about how to incorporate human values. So I'll talk about a concrete piece of work which has tried to do that. Now we know that nation has high expectations from the universities. They should provide quality education with access and inclusiveness. They should do research, connect with local social society as well as industry. On the other hand, the incoming student has very different concerns. Even though I am in IIT and talking from the point of view of what differences I see that there are similar problems we are all grappling with in higher education. The incoming undergraduate student has insecurity about his or her own future, worried about what will happen. And believe it or not, it is as true in IITs as perhaps in universities. Students are unsure of their own aspirations. They do not know what they want to do, why they have come into IIT, or why they have joined a particular course of study. Perhaps some of them have become used to taking shortcuts, and which leads to dishonesty, cheating. On the other hand, we are disconnected with our students. Call it generation gap, but general disconnection between the faculty and the students. Sometimes there are group conflicts, and the student is also perhaps a mute observer to contradictions in society as to what is happening outside, and is learning and thinking and trying to come up, cope with this reality, or learning to be ready to cope with this reality. Now, what should be done to bridge this gap? The most important part of this would be beginning with the individual, beginning with oneself, and getting the student to reflect on their own goals, and reflect on their goals in a very realistic sense, which will be related to problems which they see, which are very real to them. Develop relationship between teachers and students, and developing an understanding and a feeling of responsibility towards national and larger human goals. So this needs to be done, in my view. And background to this is, sometime when IIT directors were meeting and we were discussing many of these problems, some of the major concerns were motivating students towards studies, de-stressing them, bonding with them, making them feel a part of the institute, enlarging their vision beyond themselves. So these were the issues we were concerned with. And at that time, it was decided that we will start human values courses together with what is known as the induction program. So induction program becomes the vehicle, and human values becomes the core component, if I may say so, the backbone of the induction program. And this program started in 2016 in some of the IITs, sorry, not all the IITs, but in 2017 it spread to almost all the IITs. But the decision was in 2016 to implement this in the IITs in future. And lo and behold, AICTE also took that decision and said that the induction program must be started in all engineering colleges in which the human values component is the backbone. And this can be done in a phased manner. As a follow-up activity, AICTE also came up with a model curriculum in which space was kept for running the induction program, and the course material was sufficiently reduced in the first semester, so there is time for running the induction program, courses on human values and other things. This is being adopted and adapted by the technical universities. What do we want from our graduating student? We want them to possess knowledge in their area of study. They should be able to have an understanding of the concepts and skills, language ability, understanding about society, whether they are engineers, scientists, or students of language or social science. They should have an understanding about social, economic, and political systems where they would be functioning and living. About relationships, about how to live and work in family and at workplace, and how to do it with harmony, and above all, possess character, which is the ability to reflect, accept responsibility, act with courage, with an attitude of service. So this I have listed as what we would want our graduating student to possess. Now, how do we sort of build a program which starts moving in that direction? If you ask today, and from IIT point of view, if I look at it, and this we discussed as all the directors, that out of these five things, we are perhaps trying to do one very well, two a little bit, and about three, four, and five, whatever happens is incidental. So out of these five characteristics, we are perhaps handling one and a half. So the induction program was designed, and induction program runs in the first 3 weeks, and there are no other classes during this 3 week period. Now, what are the goals of the induction program? Assimilation in the ethos and culture of the institution. This would be based on institutional culture and practices, exposure to larger vision of life, and that is based on not narrow parochial interest, but larger human good, bonding within the batch and bonding with teachers and the new incoming batch. We feel that every student should be able to go to at least one teacher and discuss any problem he or she might be facing, whether social, psychological, financial, or academic. Learning a creative skill in the arts. This is done in engineering, so every student must choose one art form: painting, music, dance, sculpture, clay modeling, etc., and which he or she learns over a 3 week period. More regular lifestyle. Today's students sleep at night or work at night and sleep during the day. So more regular lifestyle with professional discipline. Overcoming some essential professional skill for those who might need it, like English. And essentially establish bonding, assimilation in the ethos of the institution, and develop a larger worldview. These become the goals of the induction program. These are the activities. I won't spend too much time here. Physical activity, creative arts. So there are two classes in this, number two and three. Physical activity starts in the morning, but two and three, creative arts, one art form, and human values class, each 2 hour class. But in these two classes, there are no lectures. It is all through discussion, dialogue, and practice. So let me move forward and come to the human values, which is the pivot or the backbone. In this, the class is conducted through samvad, through a dialogue, through group discussion. And we do not talk about do's and don'ts in this class. Typically about 20 undergraduate students with a faculty mentor, where this takes place. It has well-defined topics and content. And most importantly, it is not something which is abstract, it is something very concrete, and the idea is to go from concrete to abstract. So it must relate to issues in their life which are real today. This also means that the teacher who is discussing these issues has to live these values. So one of the very important outcomes, it creates a bond between a teacher and the student. I'll take you through some sample topics which are covered. And these are sort of, as you can see, in five units. The first two about student aspirations. On the first day, we discuss with them, what do you want to do? And they talk about their own aspirations, what they would like to do in their life. Sometimes they will say, no, I don't know what I want to do. About what family expects from them, and through that, gratitude, where they have reached today, who are the people who have helped them. So once they feel that sense of gratitude towards their mother, father, a primary school teacher, we tell them, you know, go home, call them up on phone, and tell them how they have helped them. And next day, some of them are emotional. That's the time when we shift, try to bring about a shift, say, now you are at a new family, which is a family of the new institution, and who are the people who are helping you have a smooth student life here. So the idea is to connect them with their with the institution where they are in, and that feeling of gratitude should spread from a few individuals to how many people are helping them. And something about, they had their breakfast this morning, we asked, they said, yes, who are the people who, because of whom, sir, my father paid for it. It's a typical response about from half the students. Then we say, who else helped? And they worry, they look, they say, no, no one else, my father paid for it. Then we bring them to the point that, who served breakfast to you? Somebody who cooked, somebody who grew food for you, and gratitude towards all of them. So the human values, which, and these are universal values. In fact, our course is called Universal Human Values. So these are universal, and in all cultures, in all societies, this is a value. No society would say, don't have gratitude. So therefore, we have picked all those universal elements, both at the individual level, then at the personal relation level, and with society. Then we take them from competition, IIT students who have joined with an intense competition, to take them to cooperation. And goal being excellence, and not just a lower goal of doing better than someone else. In fact, the higher goal of excellence and contributing towards society, doing something that has not been done before, is what should inspire them. We also have a session on ragging and how to deal with it as a first year student. But we dropped this because after we started running this course, ragging disappeared. We even forgot to form the mandatory committee 1 year, year before last. And my dean of students said, sir, we forgot to do that because this has just disappeared.
You may be in trouble, sir.
Yes, so he told me that we might be in trouble. So, but he said, no, things were so good, I didn't want to disturb. We didn't form the committee. Human needs, then we take them to needs, and where this feeling that money is the most important part. So that we want to take up as part of human values. What is money for? So there we begin from, not that money is not important, but what are the needs of the self and needs of the body. Needs of the body can be satisfied by money. Needs of the self are satisfied by feelings and emotions and relationships. So we take them through concept, what it means to be prosperous. And it is not money alone. We need sufficient money to live, certainly. And prosperity means you have more than that, but it doesn't yet give you that feeling of samriddhi or prosperity. Then peer pressure, self-confidence, English as a source of self-respect, which is an issue. We take these issues head on. These discussions are also conducted in the language in which students feel comfortable. So we have groups which freely discuss it in Hindi. And if there are students who do not understand Hindi, we tell them you can speak in English. If you understand Hindi but cannot speak Hindi, that's all right. And if you do not understand anything, then the teacher takes care of it. although we do not segregate groups based on language. Then relationship, values in relationship, trust, respect, mamata, vatsalya, snehe, prem, gaurav, shraddha, etc. Then coming to nature and environment, and for society, we actually took the example of freedom movement. It also happens to be 15th August. We showed them the Gandhi film. It was seen by 1,100 students and 50 or 70 teachers. 70 teachers get involved in running this. And after that, we passed them a set of questions to ponder on the film, what they have already seen. And those are discussed in again in groups of 20 in their respective groups. So the idea is to design, is designed to gain clarity about issues of life. Today, young person is actually confused, and we should work to take him or her out. And to taking them out means actually self-reflection. Experience, the good part of this has been that the students as well as teachers have liked it immensely. And this program's in human values has been experimented and running for last 12 years. But this program in various places, and this program actually, the induction program, this time which they got for 3 weeks was intensely liked, and extremely positive feedback came from the students as well as the faculty, which is normally a rare thing. What we teachers like, students don't like. What students like, we say, no, they are wasting their time. This was one example where they really liked everything. So they resulted in bonding among students, relationship between teachers and students, sensitization to their living environment, assimilation in the ethos and culture of the institution, and students' attention has been drawn to themselves, larger issues of life, and responsibility towards nation or larger society, as well as nature and environment. We have a follow-up course in the fourth semester. This is called Universal Human Values 2, where we focus more on society. That also runs for all students in the same groups. And this induction program is now spreading very fast. Sometimes we're a little afraid the speed at which it is spreading in all the colleges. We are running workshops. There are 5,000 colleges, and AICTE has made it mandatory. So universities are adapting it in their own way. But that requires teacher training for at least, it takes about several months for teachers to accept these issues and do a internal process in which they imbibe these things. So that process is going on in the country. And by the way, the Universal Human Values program is running in about 3,000 colleges. Today, 2,000 colleges in Andhra Pradesh, 600 colleges in Uttar Pradesh, 300 colleges in Punjab, and now in the IITs, some of the NITs, and it is spreading. I believe that this is only the first step, where it is not intellectual learning, but feeling it. To make that effective, the assignments, practical things which they need to do are put into the course. So I'll stop here.
Thank you, Professor Sangal. Let's join hands for thanking him. He has given a very good insight into the new experiment they are doing with the imparting of value education in all the professional institutions. As also rightly said that this is becoming a bigger thing, and also being followed by some of the statutory agencies like AICT. So an induction program has been made mandatory, and some of the value education can be delivered during the induction program itself. We are very happy that Professor Sangal is facing the problem, and that is a problem of plenty, that he has a lot of request on his hand to do something in this domain, and I think we should come forward to help him promote such values if we can. So with that, I'll let this open for only two questions. My request, third hand, please let it not be raised, because we have enough time during lunchtime or later to talk to him. He's available. I can request Professor Sangal to be available to us beyond evening also, if so required. So two questions, please. Yeah, one and two there, that's all.
Mr. Chairperson of the session, through Professor Sangal as well as this is for everybody. This what induction program he was talking about, we are experimenting, it brings out a very good result, no doubt about it. But the very issue is pertinent to the teachers. Somebody was talking about curriculum for teachers. How are we going to change the mindset of the teachers? And especially, honestly, we would agree that young teachers are adapting it very quickly. But the senior old doyens, you know, as usual, the problem is persist. What is your experience? How do you to overcome that?
So we, in the last 1 year, some 2,000 teachers have been trained. I don't like the word trained, but it is sensitized and they start coming in their own way. We run a 3-day program followed by a 7-day workshop. 3-day workshop followed by a 7-day workshop. And general feedback on this teacher training program, teacher training workshop, this is a very good idea. And about 80% of the people who come in say that it is very useful. I want to bring my wife into this workshop. Is it possible? So we touch with the teachers, we touch upon their issues.
Thank you.
And their issues about family, their issues in the institution. So they feel it is mine. And then we tell them, when a student is, we tell the students, you should study for the sake of knowledge, not for the sake of job. So we ask the teachers, are you doing research for the sake of promotion or for the sake of contributing something to society? So the idea is to make them think. And by and large, the response is positive. About 80% people say it is very good. 10% have doubts. And the doubt, you are right, some of the senior people have more doubts because they have seen things which don't work. My own feeling is that as this program, if it yields results, then people will change their views. And people should have an open mind to go and see, even the older teachers, and see whether it works.
Thank you, sir. Last one, please.
That's not for me to say. It is good that it is done little stepwise. Otherwise, it will be extremely hard.
I think the answer to that question lies with us only, that we can adopt it and he's ready to help us with that. That's what the offer was made from his side. So thank you, Professor Sangal. Thank you, everyone, for their contributions and questions. We have the next speaker now, that is Professor Anita Patankar. As was informed to me earlier, that she's going to be a replacement for the speakers earlier, but she's now going to make only a 2-minute presentation about an event, the international education related event, which is going to happen in Symbiosis.
Yeah.
And therefore this is a small change. And as a change, we had a request from Professor AKS Suryavanshi, Vice Chancellor of SGT University, who was since morning requesting us for a small slot for sharing his idea on some disruptive technologies or something related to that. So he'll be given 5 minutes to speak to us so that we have one alternative speaker there. Yeah, madam, please.
Good afternoon and thank you, sir. First, my very sincere apologies on behalf of Drs. Rajiv and Vidya Yerodekar due to a family emergency. They were not able to make it. I am no expert in health promotion and disruptive technologies in health promotion. And therefore, unfortunately, I am not going to be able to make that presentation or answer any questions. But I must thank AIU for therefore giving me 2 minutes to talk to you about something that I passionately believe in, and that is internationalization of higher education. Some of you honored us last year around the same time in April by coming to the first SIU AIU conference on internationalization of higher education, in which we talked about the changing landscape of internationalization of higher education. Data from across the world talks to us about how less than 2% globally, less than 2% students actually travel abroad. Less than 2% faculty actually travel abroad, which means that in almost all countries, 98% of students and faculty never ever travel abroad, especially during their education years, learning years, and therefore never get an international exposure. But the fact is that the world is changing, and the world is changing really, really fast, and it's changing in terms of internationalization and globalization. So whether Indian students actually go abroad to work or not, the fact is the world is coming to India. And even Indian organizations are changing in the way they are responding. And therefore, this year's theme is on a concept that is now gaining a lot of importance, and that is internationalization at home. How do we change, enrich, nurture, enhance our curriculum as well as our campus at home so that the students who study here with us are prepared for the world of tomorrow? This is the theme, and I invite you to a three-day deliberation and discussion. The first day, which is the 5th, is a curtain raiser. It is a roundtable discussion only meant for senior academics and vice chancellors, in which we will talk about internationalization at home as a parameter for entering into national and world rankings. One of the things that NIRF has done is brought rankings into our backyard and front yard as well. And does internationalization at home count? Does it matter? Does it change the way we look at our teaching learning process? Does it change the way we look at research? So the roundtable discussion on the 5th, which is from 2 o'clock to 6 p.m., will focus on internationalization at home and its impact on ratings, on national rankings, as well as on global rankings. The conference on the 6th and the 7th will focus directly on the issues related to internationalization at home. We have national as well as international speakers. Let me see whether I can bring up a list of speakers for you. 6th and 7th will talk about the concept of internationalization at home. It'll bring in entrepreneurs, social entrepreneurs, and corporate employers who will talk about why competencies that are related to international, global, and intercultural competencies count. We will also have case studies from across the world, India and outside, on how people are trying to internationalize the curriculum as well as the campus. And the last track will talk about problems and challenges faced when you try to internationalize the curriculum. Is there a sacrifice that you have to make in terms of local needs? Or do they go hand in hand? We have two keynote speakers. Dr. Hans DeWitt from the Boston College is an expert in internationalization at home. He is the keynote speaker on day one. The Honorable Minister for MHRD, for HRD is the speaker, Shri Prakash Javadekar, on the second day. As you can see, we have a number of very well-known researchers as well as academics from the field who will speak. So let me thank you on behalf of the Chancellor, the Vice-Chancellor, and the Pro-Chancellor of Symbiosis. Please do visit us. AIU has sent you an invite. I will write as organizing secretary again to you to remind you. We are happy to take care of all your requirements during those 3 days. I look forward, because I think this is an important discussion, that while many will go abroad and many will work with global organizations, a majority of our students actually will not. They will stay home. How do we make sure that they can also leverage on the advantages that India will offer and will have? Thank you so much, and thank you once again for giving me this opportunity to inform you about the details about this program. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Patnaikar. I'm sure all the information which Madam was willing to share or present here is available also in print form as well as in the electronic form. Do collect it. I'm saying it on your behalf, Madam. And internationalization is a key activity for all of us. Let's take a plunge and start doing something which will add diversity to our campuses and enrich ourselves. I'll now invite another speaker, as I informed earlier, Dr. A.K.S. Suryavanshi, Vice Chancellor of SGT University. He'll take 5 minutes to make his presentation on technological disruptions.
Thank you, sir. No, I'm not making presentations. Change will change if you are willing to change or unwilling to change. Because the theme goes forward ever and forward ever. Agre Sarat Sarvada. Dr. Sancheti, Dr. Patankar, Dr. Sangal, Professor Furkan Kamarji, and all my senior colleagues, senior vice chancellor, were very, very senior to me here, my colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen. Very warm good afternoon to all of you. There are a few things I'm going to share with you, which I have been also grappling with the same situation and the same disruptions. And with some work done abroad with Robert Kennedy College and other places, I can say that one example, for example, today youth, if you have to call your son and the daughter from the upstairs that the dinner is ready, please come down. They may respond, may not respond. But if you send them a WhatsApp message, dinner is ready, come down. They will simply text back, yeah, coming in a second. So the context has changed. And if you are just stuck up there, probably even if you don't want to change, the change will change us. And why I'm saying, because UGC, if you remember, sir, the guidelines is there for MOOCs, massive open online courses, up to 20% credit a student can learn. But how many of us have really implemented it in our university? I, for one, have implemented hardly 3% so far. So that means we are not also willing to very fast induct the disruptions. And the concept like the classroom will vanish, I don't agree. Because classroom will become enriched classroom even if the class is less held. The classroom will move away from the classroom, but the physical classroom will still remain. Two analogy. When in 90s we were in the school and the college days, you remember there was a theme saying that the youth is becoming very scientific, very much materialistic, so the places of worship will vanish. It has not vanished. In fact, it has increased. Then when the internet and digital era came, they said newspaper will stop publishing. The newspaper circulation have increased. That means there are some value system which will always remain in society, and the classroom is one which will always remain. But if you feel that 9 to 4 the classroom will be taking place, that's not going to happen. Maybe the classroom will shrink to 3 hours, 3.5 hours, a place of deliberations, disruptions, talking and challenging, where the faculty may not know the all. Sometimes students may know better, but as a faculty, as a teacher, we should feel very proud that the student has been able to find a better answers and share with the whole class. Now, MOOCs, why I said that I'm in the part of a committee, which is a joint committee of IIT Bombay, IIM Bangalore for the management courses. And I can share with you a lot of MOOCs courses any university can develop. We all have the scheme from UGC. If you write to them that we want to develop some MOOCs, and 10 universities here can collaborate through the president-elect office, saying that 5 universities are good in medical, 5 are good in engineering. In engineering also, mechanical and so on and so forth. Professor Sangal here taking a lead under your leadership also. Maybe we collaborate maybe by tomorrow morning and we write to the president-elect office, say that we will develop a MOOC course together, 10 universities, and send it to UGC, so a platform. That's going to work wonder because it's like collaborative working. So not only in India, but other universities abroad also, we can collaborate, and I think we all should do that. I'm also trying, just struggling reluctantly, but doing it somehow. Second, the classroom context and the shape will change for simulation. We are, suppose somebody has to explain biochemistry, or for example, let's say extrusion technology in food, probably it will take at least half day to really explain that. But today, you run a simulation, and simulation can teach the same thing in just 1 hour. So more and more simulation will be used in the classroom. Why digital era is disrupting our way of teaching is because they are pretty fast. They are almost like a kind of digitization, but they are on simulation. Somebody says that the leadership cannot be taught. It can be taught. For example, singing cannot be taught. It can be taught if there is a method. Why I'm saying, because for example, there is a simulation called empathy. Okay, then I have just 2 minutes. Third, I want to share with you is that experiential learning. I think our classroom, some of the students with us had to go out more, and here the local context comes. And Harvard University will not solve the problem of Sarnath and Varanasi. So that means I as a university in Bhopal or Pune or anywhere, I localized in my expertise and the whole world runs from my case study. That these guys have done something very different. Third, the next point is that today, let's understand, students of these days don't believe in abstract thing. We have to really convince them with logic and scientific evidence. If you talk abstract, it's not going to work with this generation. So we have to find a way of having very scientific conclusions. And one more thing, sir, with your permission, just last moment, we have to create the spirit of entrepreneurship among the students. That's very, very important. And then as a teacher, we have to also become entrepreneur, even if system doesn't permit. System doesn't permit today to us, like it's not a US system. We can become entrepreneur. It's very important to think like entrepreneurship. Flipped classroom will be another. I don't think many of us, including me, do the flipped classroom. Suppose we have a partner university in Johannesburg. I have the class conducted and we can flip the classroom. Lab issues, and the last, sir, just 30 seconds, I'll close. Tomorrow, with the Washington Accord signature, Indian University will be part of it sooner or the later. Maybe a student can choose a degree that is multi-university, degree is one, but he takes part of the course from Europe, part of the course from India, part of the course from different places. So let's be ready for this change. Thank you so much, sir, for permission to share my thoughts. Thank you, have a great day.
Thank you, Professor Suryavanshi. Thank you for maintaining the time. Questions, if any, to him, may be addressed directly to him on one-to-one basis. Friends, this leaves me with maybe 5-7 minutes to share my thoughts. I couldn't do it in the beginning. I couldn't do it yesterday also, let me tell you, because the sessions were running awfully late and so was it today. But we'll certainly save something like half an hour today, collectively between the two sessions which have been assigned to me. I'll just quickly share my thoughts on the disruption. I happen to dwell on this issue because I'm from the technology, and I personally believe that technology is the one which has created most disruptions. Yes, social domain will also do certain things. Political domain will also do. So going by that, I'll possibly say that the disruptions in the technological domain probably would happen by what we call inventions and generally not by innovations. Innovations are generally very small step in terms of progress or change. Of course, good step, maybe more commercial. Inventions were never generally considered to be commercial, but a much bigger step. And this I'm saying not from my knowledge. I've probably not read history as well as many of you know, but I was fortunate to hear one gentleman called Mohandas Pai recently, 2 months back. And in his address of roughly 40 minutes, he covered 500 years of history of mankind. And he always related every change happening there to a technological change. And some of them, if I can recapture, probably would be the invention of the wheel, which must have been much earlier and probably he didn't cover. But then he said that what steam engine did to the entire world in terms of shifting the political or economical balances, everything was there. The dynamite also did the same thing. The wireless communication when it happened in early 1900 also made the change, later 1900 also made the changes. The later the changes came through the internet, the later now we are talking about the AI. AI obviously is a thing which is directly related to us. Intelligence is something which we thought lies in the people who are educated, who can think critically, who can dissent and be differentiators. And we know that today is a world of knowledge economy or knowledge century is where we are living. And knowledge is something which is nothing but in the sequence of data, information, knowledge, wisdom, they're all related and they plow back to each other, they support each other. And since we live in this particular domain, and since how to collect data, how to interpret data, how to apply data, how to derive wisdom out of that is probably all related to intelligence. And therefore, AI will possibly have a huge impact on our education system, is my personal belief. And AI is also going to replace many standard functions which routinely are being done by mankind. And maybe to some extent, you can say teaching also became a routine for certain reasons at a certain level. And therefore, who knows, AI may also impact all those things. And therefore, disruptions driven by technology have a better potential or reason to impact us, going by the history. All the major changes which have happened, whether we followed technology when we had Nalandas and others, and whether we became complacent and others followed technology, is for you to probably think. But the technology is the one which has enabled these disruptions. And therefore, let's accept the fact that this is bound to apply to us. There was a question in the morning, is it for the right thing or is it for the wrong thing? Let me answer it technically itself. Let me tell you that we all know that good goes with bad, and maybe black with white, or maybe head with tail, or whatever. These are common examples, whether you accept it or not. But from the technology standpoint of view, I'm an electronics engineer. Many of you would be here in that same background. I would very easily say that there is a thing called signal and there is a thing called noise. When we want signal, we don't want noise. But there is a fact that there cannot be a signal without noise. The very origin of the signal is nothing but the noise itself. And therefore, that the positive and negative will coexist. Our effort should be how to minimize the negative and how to maximize the positive, and that would be less disruption, but disruptions are going to happen, in my opinion. I'll just share last two thoughts on this particular thing, and that's something more critical, especially the first one. The second one is more futuristic. You may ask me a question, but I would not have the answer for that, let me tell you. The first one is, whether the universities will continue to exist or not is something we need to ponder over, because we'll not then be called as the vice chancellors, and there won't be any AIU, and there won't be any such meeting either. And the reason for that is, teaching learning is our domain. If I say knowledge imparting, it's through teaching learning process. Teaching learning happens right from day one, from mother, maybe from parents, maybe from family, maybe from neighborhood, maybe from NGOs, maybe from friends. It also happens in the schools where the formal teachers are there, and obviously in the society, broader society, industrial society, and the education institutions like ours. But who has given this license for you to do that? That you will be the only person to stamp the degrees. You will be the only persons who will say you are educated and you are not educated. We have seen enough people in the past who are not educated formally, but they've done wonders. Many industrialists are there. So the point I'm trying to make you to ponder over right now is whether the universities will have the critical and the only domain of giving degrees, or whether it can be any other agency doing it. A simple coaching institution also does some teaching learning. They may be having a focused point. I'm not necessarily promoting them to a level of ours, but still they are also working in the same domain. Can they give a certificate, and can that certificate be very valid for someone to get employed with that? Would the university degree be needed in future to in future times to come is what we need to ponder. And in that context, I can only say a simple statement that in the new knowledge, with the AI, with the lot of technology coming in, people with more skills, people with more adaptability, people with more interdisciplinarity, whatever such features may be, would be the people who will be sought after, rather than people only with the so-called piece of degree which we have. So piece of degree may still remain important. I'm not saying anything like that will vanish so soon, but there is a potential that the universities may cease to exist. However, the other counter example to that would be from the technology, once again from the electronics, that anything or everything, whether it is a copper wire, or whether it is the optical fiber, or it's a coaxial cable, or the free space optical, or the microwave or satellite or anything, they have found their own place. They have coexisted with the new technologies and the old technologies. So I personally believe that the universities should do well and change themselves so that they coexist. But if we don't change, that potential would be there. We'll not be able to disregard the disruption, is the point I try to make with this. That is number one. I'll probably substantiate it by one more thing. The need of exam would also change. As it is already in one of the committees where I was also a member, it's called Kakutkar Committee, we have already outlined that the evaluations and examinations will possibly change to group evaluations. It's not what knowledge I have acquired and how many marks I get. It's the knowledge which I can disseminate, share, excite people with, apply, and therefore there will be group evaluations, not only in practical but in theory also. That is what we had proposed some 5-6 years back. I know it will take time to see or see the light of the day for that kind of a thing, because it's very difficult. But once that happens, you will find that even the toppers will work with the others to educate them and raise the average. What we really need in the country today is raise the average of our education level. And I'm sure through such changes of group evaluations, etc., these will come. So once again, the domain of examination will change. And once the examination changes, the outcome is a degree or a certificate that will also change. So that's the point I wanted to make. The second point, of course, is I don't have a logic, but I still will make it because I've heard it in some of the conferences, that there is a likely potential that even internet will cease to exist. Internet will probably be modified to the extent that what you understand today will not be the internet of tomorrow. And once that changes, you know that all these MOOCs which we are talking about are the virtual labs or the virtual examinations or the virtual universities or ultimately the virtual degrees, whatever it may be, will change because the internet will also change. The mode through which we use and deliver this knowledge will also change. And therefore, the existence of internet can also change because there can be a time. I have seen a movie way back in 1983, which was at that time called Android, that there'll be a chip inserted in your head through whatever connections and other things. If you know that brain mapping was happening, someone was talking about that. If the brain is mapped, then it can be controlled also. It can be understood also. A chip can make you function like whatever you want. You have to think differently and do differently. If that happens, there can be another chip which can be shooting or putting every data in your head. You don't have to go around and access the internet and find out something. We already know that there is a sixth sense which is already available, done by an Indian person, Pranav Mistry, from, I think it was from Nirma, if I'm not wrong. Sixth sense is obviously adding value and power to our thinking. There can be a seventh sense, which I don't know what it would be, but there can be a seventh sense because the degrees of such things are increasing day by day. And therefore, friends, my own humble submission here is disruption is bound to happen. Disruption will happen. How much we need to adopt and how we can take advantage on the positive side of it will make us winner. And that's what we should try to crave for. With that, I'd like to conclude the session. I'm also available for the questions if there are any, but possibly on one-to-one basis, once again to save the time. So with that, I'd like to conclude the part one of the session, post-tea session which we had. And we were given 1 hour and 20 minutes for that. We probably have done it in 1 hour and 20 minutes in this particular case. So thank you, Professor Sangal. Thank you, Professor Suryavanshi. Thank you, Professor Patankar. I'll request them to take their seats in the front. We move on to the second part of the session, which is the presentation and interaction by the sponsors. Friends, this is very important. Our sponsors support us and enlighten us with their new ideas and challenges. In the process, they help us conduct these events also very smoothly. There were more people, but I'm told that there are only 2 people now available for such a presentation right now. And may I now request both of them to be present here? Can they come on the dais? And request them to take 10 minutes each so that in the next 20 minutes, we'll be ready for the lunch. So I'll also request the members to kindly remain seated and give their due to the sponsors of this particular event. We have 2 sponsors who are available here. One is Power Glit, Mr. Nahata. Mr. Nahata? You are Mr. Nahata. From Power Glit, Power Glit. Okay, I was given Power Glit here. Anyway, and the second set of promoters are Mr. and Mrs. Arora. Is that fine? They are going to talk about the plagiarism related activity or maybe software. So, Mr. Nahata, can I request you to make your presentation? Not more than 10 minutes. At 8 minutes, I'll sound the microphone for you.
Is it visible? Yeah, it is visible. From post time. How do I go to what is, yeah, I want to show this.
You want?
I want to begin from here.
It is from here, sir, only.
Okay, what I can't see what's being shown.
It's showing everywhere.
Okay. And, next slide will be. Good afternoon. My name is Vineet Nahata. I represent Power Guild Treasuries. We happen to be operating in the financial services universe, and our forte is treasury management. The fixed income universe basically means the investment of your funds in avenues where there is zero capital erosion, the safety and security of money remains completely intact, and then you earn regular interest income. This is our area of operation. We facilitate investment in fixed income debt instruments, that is bonds and securities, maximizing the returns of your fixed income portfolio, keeping the safety and security of money intact. That happens to be our aim, and 100% safety and security of capital is the topmost priority. These are the various investing entities to whom we are serving: Provident Fund Trust, Gratuity and Superannuation Trust, Charitable Trust, Clubs, Registered Societies, Religious, Social and Educational Trusts and Institutions. Universities fall here. Other than that, corporates, FIIs, NRIs and individuals. In the individual capacity, if you would like to invest money, then like you can call on us. These are the various investment avenues where the investments can be made. First is the sovereign Government of India bonds, the gilts or the GSEC. Reserve Bank of India issues these government securities to fund their fiscal deficit. This year in the budget, it was announced that we are going to have a fiscal deficit of around 3.5%. Our income is short compared to the expenditure what we made on various defense, like and other allied public activities. So the shortfall is being bridged by government's borrowing program where they issue securities. We subscribe to the auctions, take the securities in our books, and then further downsell them to these institutions. Second happens to be public sector undertaking bonds of government-owned companies like Power Finance Corporation, Rural Electrification Corporation, National Highway Authority, etc. Third avenue happens to be the government-guaranteed bonds. These bonds are issued by central government as well as state government, where the interest and principal is unconditionally and irrevocably guaranteed by the respective governments. There cannot be any event of default either in interest or in the principal. The interest rates are also quite attractive. Fourth avenue is the bonds of nationalized banks like State Bank of India, Bank of Baroda, Vijaya Bank. Here, a special reference has to be made. The banks which do not fall under the preventive and corrective action. As we all know, certain banks at present are having a heavy debt burden of non-performing assets. These NPAs have reduced the capital adequacy ratio of the banks, and some of the banks are like literally on the verge of bankruptcy. So there are seven banks which Reserve Bank of India has declared that these are risk prone, so we avoid them. And the banks which are financially very healthy, where the investors' money can be safely parked, we only stick to those particular bonds, those particular banks. And the last category is the tax-free and zero coupon bonds, which are not for institutions which are tax exempt like universities. These are for individual, if in your individual capacity, if you would like to invest, these tax-free bonds give you a very high post-tax yield. Now I'd like to draw upon the difference between fixed deposits and bonds. Fixed deposits happen to be the most simplest and the convenient way of investing your money. Most of the universities are parking their funds in fixed deposits. The interest rates what we get right now in nationalized bank fixed deposits is nothing more than 6.5% to 7%. the same bank which is issuing a fixed deposit at 6% offers bonds at anywhere between 9 to 9.5%, and there's a reason why the same bank which is issuing a FD at 6.5% offers 2 to 3% higher interest on the bonds. The first reason is the Reserve Bank has asked all the banks who are borrowing in fixed deposits to maintain a SLR ratio, statutory liquidity ratio, to the tune of around 20.5%. 20.5% of the money which the bank has borrowed from FD goes into government securities. Only the balance 80% odd amount is given to corporates as loans, or it is given to individuals for home loans, auto loans, etc. So the bank is not making money on the 20% of the fixed deposit they have derived back, because that money is stuck. Second thing is, in comparison to this, had the bank gone in for a bond issue, the whole amount of funds could have been lent by the bank, and which would have been used in productive way to earn money for them. Second thing is that the overhead costs of servicing the bank fixed deposit is very high. The typical denomination of a bank fixed deposit is, say, 1,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees or 20,000 rupees. There are millions of investors who happen to be investing small ticket fixed deposits with the banks. They have invested it today, after a month they take it out. Again they invest, after 5 days, again they take it out. So the bank always has to keep on a vigil that tomorrow I might be have to service the debt of fixed deposit holders. So they have to maintain a cushion or a buffer stock of liquid money which might be needed by the fixed depositors upon redemption. Secondly, the overhead costs of calculation of interest, receiving the money, disbursing the money of fixed deposit holders is very high. A lot of manpower is being deployed simply in calculating and payment of interest, which is a non-productive activity for a bank. It's not generating revenue. So deliberately the banks offer a lower rate of interest on their fixed deposits and offer a higher rate of interest in bonds. So selection of bonds as an investment avenue compared to fixed deposits is a better choice for the institutions. Other features are, there's no TDS on interest income of bonds. There is easy liquidity. Bonds, if you need money easily, you can sell them off. And capital appreciation is also possible in bonds because they happen to be a negotiable security. And for individuals and corporates, there is a long-term capital gain tax. Tax rate is only 10% after a year, which is not there in fixed deposits. The binding section, as far as our universities are concerned, most of the universities are registered under section, have exemption of section 80G, and the governing section is section 11.5 of the Income Tax Act. So these are the various investment avenues which section 11.5 of Income Tax Act provide. FD is one of them. The others happen to be the government securities and post office schemes. The second slide will show you that any security for money created and issued by central government or state government. So these government securities and bonds of various public sector undertakings are permitted as an approved security by Section 11.5 of the Income Tax Act, which the universities can easily invest in. These are some of the examples of government securities. The 10-year G-Sec right now is giving you a yield of 7.8%. The other, we've given like the other examples. Some is a Tamil Nadu state loan, Maharashtra state loan. There are some Uday bonds. There's one security called 9.75 Uttar Pradesh Power, so which is giving you a 9.5% yield. So all of them are approved securities where you can invest. And this is a list of public sector undertaking bonds. PSU bonds, Power Finance, NABARD, Indian Railway, all of them are giving around 8.5 to 9%. So you can invest in these bonds. We happen to be the facilitators. You can always call on us for advisory. And now in the, especially the, in the aftermath of the recent PNB scam, and as far as the PCA guideline issued by Reserve Bank of India, that most of the banks have been rendered virtually unsafe as far as investments are concerned. I would suggest that you seriously look upon investing in Reserve Bank of India sovereign securities and state government and central government guaranteed bonds, because all your money in fixed deposit, be it a crore or 10 crore or 100 crore, only 1 lakh rupee is guaranteed by DICGC. The rest of your money is completely unsecure. We have had instances in the past where private institutions, they have not been able to repay the money. And already we are seeing that the money is at risk with certain notified public sector banks also. So I would request that you call on us. We are always there to help you out in structuring your fixed income portfolio.
Nata sir, thank you so Thanks much. A lot. Thank you. Bye. I'm sure he'll keep the information available to us on the registration table, and he's also going to be
we
available
have a stall
to us
here.
During
you can
the lunch
always
time.
Visit the stall.
Please take advantage of his offerings there. Thank you. We'll now invite the last speaker for the session. Both of you are going to make the presentation. Mr. Arora is going to make the presentation. Please go ahead.
Which one? It's not there. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank AIU for giving us this opportunity to be here in front of people like you. We are here from yesterday, and we are meeting you in person during tea session, during lunch. And with this, we are trying to make you sensitized and aware about the product we have launched. It's an anti-plagiarism software. This is the software which we have developed over a period of 2 years. Till now, because of the internet, because the topic of this conference is technology disruption, so because of the internet, we have seen there is a rampant increase in the plagiarism, and there is a complete, I won't say huge, there is a complete dependency on foreign products. When we say that we want to check the similarity. So here we have tried to come up with a solution. We call it Check for Plag, which is, we call it as an abbreviation CFP. And it is truly Make in India product. Our company is duly registered with Startup India, which is an ambitious program from Government of India. So we have registered with that. Why we are here for? We want you to be aware of. We are reaching your institutions through different channels like social media, digital marketing. We are also reaching you through the libraries or through the dean sir, through the registrar sirs. So as and when it is possible for us, our sales team, our telemarketing team is in place. They are reaching you out. What we expect from you? We expect from you is your support, your suggestions, because we are more onto the technical side. Though we have taken good information, good inputs to develop it according to the Indian education system, still we expect that if you can give us more support in terms of your valuable feedback, so that would be nice for us. That would be, and I would like not only one way this. One slide on. So my idea of being here is not only to communicate from my side, I would also like any inputs. So don't wait for sirs, knock 8 minutes or 10 minutes. So if you have any questions regarding this product, regarding our service, it's a cloud-based service. It's available 24/7. We provide you login credentials, institution, within institution. You can have it for the faculty-wise or the department-wise. It can be used by all the students. So this is how it has been designed. The report is generated in the PDF format. It gives the similarity percentage, similarity into percentage. It also gives you the all the URLs from the from where the information might have been taken, copied, or similar to. So we are not saying that it is copied. We are saying this might have been taken from here. So we also leave a scope for the faculty or the person to decide whether if a proper citation has been given, so you can manage the report. So that option is there. So all URLs and within the URL, the content from which it might have been taken from, copied from, is also available there. So we are the first one to introduce the SMS facility. Once you upload the document, once and the report is ready, immediately SMS notification comes into place. So whichever registered mobile number is there, you get a SMS onto that. Simultaneously, you also get alert onto your email ID also. So that facility is also there. I would like if you have any questions regarding this, any one of you. Please, sir. Sir, very relevant question asked. As of now, we have added English language. But we do have a plan because the product has been developed for India. Whensoever I go to southern states, they always ask about if you have support Malayalam, if you support Kannada. So we have a plan of. But for that, we have to first index the information available over internet in that language. So we are into process of that. Subsequent to this, I would like also to add on that we are also in the process of digitizing the rare documents which are available into various institutes which are not available currently onto internet. So we, because today if say if a 40 years old book which is available into some library and there is no soft copy of that available, if somebody copies from that, no software, not only ours, even if the leaders, they can't detect it because everything runs onto internet. So we do have a plan of bringing that information also under the scanner, under the this scope of this software, sir. So, but it will take time, but we do have a longer term plan, in a longer term vision, we are going to do that.
Yeah, one more.
Sir, as of now, it has not been certified by anybody, but at the same time, no other software is also being authorized, certified, or authenticated. Sir, I'll be coming on to that. In year 2015, UGC came up with a tender wherein they wanted to procure a anti-plagiarism software. I was there in that meeting and I don't want to share with that. Earlier I thought I won't be, but it is from that meeting only we thought of making this program, this software. So at that time Urkund was there, which is currently UGC is supplying. We are also in touch with UGC. We have given them a comparative analysis of our software and currently distributed by them software. And we are convinced that we have exceeded them in terms of quality, in terms of price, in terms of any other thing, which is like I have shared with you, the SMS facility, which is unique in class, that is not being provided by any of the softwares currently.
Okay, Arora sir, can I intervene? Please, here? I think it's some good features have been added and you learned from the experiences of the previous vendors. Very nice. We'll certainly have more questions, but may I ask you if you have a trial version,
yes,
or
sure,
trial
sir.
Access available,
sure, sir.
You can just announce about that in case you are giving it, because a user experience by trying it would be much more important than by you sharing that.
Yeah.
So can you let people know about that?
Definitely. So we are here, trials are openly available till the time you are satisfied. So if you are currently using any other software, I don't want to name anyone, you do the same report generation from our software, do a comparative yourself and then think of. So it is not that we are here to sell.
So we are happy that you are open to that.
Yes, yes.
What
yes,
is
yes.
the modus operandi for trial? Let's say an ex-professor or vice-chancellor wants to use it for a month's trial.
Yeah.
How will you give the access? Surely. Kindly explain.
Surely. So we are here. You can exchange the card. Just drop us a line that you are interested in trial. We do have a form over our web portal, which is www.checkforplaque.com. And there you can fill up the required details. You can tell your librarian, dean sir, registrar sir, anybody who is taking care of, because we are working with institute. With every institute there is a different format. In certain cases there are PhD in charges. In certain cases we are approached by HODs. So whosoever works onto this can fill up a form, or you can exchange cards with us. Our information is available and we'll be happy to provide you trial. Trial is not with the duration, sir.
Okay, fine. That's enough.
Yeah.
The basics are fine, that yeah. how to go about it. So yeah. thank you, Mr. Arora.
Yeah.
Thank you, Madam Arora, also for joining us.
Yeah.
My dear friends, with that, the first two sessions, which were scheduled before the lunch break, are over now. We have saved 10-15 minutes out of whatever 2 hours which were allocated to us collectively. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your good questions and making the session very lively. The announcement is we get 40 minutes for the lunch. 2:30, all of you are requested to join back for the remaining sessions here, because in the evening probably there are more exciting things, so let's not try to delay that. So kindly join us for the lunch now, and thank you for your presence.